My name is Daniel Blackburn, and today we're going to talk about biochar. What is biochar? How do you make it? What is it useful for? So let's get into it. So what is biochar? First of all, that's very simple. Biochar is charcoal. Why don't we call it charcoal? The reason we don't call it charcoal is because we want to make a distinction that biochar is not produced for burning or for using as a source of energy or for barbecues. Biochar is produced with the single purpose of using it as a soil amendment. So what does it do as a soil amendment? It enhances the physical and chemical properties of the soil and the biological properties of the soil. It increases infiltration rate, water retention. It also increases the microbial biomass and activity in the soil, and also the cation exchange capacity from the soils and the ability of the soils of holding nutrients. So it's a very useful amendment. And to make the difference between charcoal, which is usually mixed with some paraffin or any fuel to help ignite that biochar, the charcoal. The biochar is not mixed with any fuel. It's just simple charcoal made with the purpose of using in soils as an amendment for helping the fertility of soils, the quality of the soils, and the health of the soils. And why biochar instead of compost, for example, other sources of organic matter? The reason that we want biochar instead of compost or vermicompost or other source of organic matter is it's a long-lasting carbon amendment. When you add crop residues, when you add compost and any amendments for that matter, organic amendments, this has a short life in the soil. In tropical climates, in arid climates, hot climates, the compost that you add this year, next year will be completely gone and will be completely decomposed, mineralized by the soil microbes. The advantage of the biochar is that the biochar will not be quickly degraded by the microbes. It is resistant for being degraded by soil microbes. So we use that biochar as an amendment for improving soil properties, not as a food or as a source of nutrient for the soil. If we use a compost, if we use a vermicompost, we are actually stimulating the microbial biomass by giving them food. And we are improving plant growth by giving nutrients that are continuously being released by the mineralization of that organic matter. But with biochar is different. You have some amount of nutrients that are coming, but not as much as you would get from the compost. But the main property that you have is a conditioner of the soil properties. It will improve the hydraulic properties of the soil. It will improve also the chemical and biological properties of this soil. So this is biochar. It's just charcoal that you use it for as a soil amendment. And how do you make biochar? Yeah, before thinking about how do you make biochar, where does it come from? You know, the idea of biochar is that some soils in the Amazon forest, when you describe those forests, they will normally this in Amazon forest, the soils are very poor, very acidic, low fertility, very sandy, continuously being washed by rainfall. But some soils in the Amazon forest were found out that they were dark, rich in organic matter, very fertile. And further description of those soils led to the discovery that those soils were anthropogenic, which means that humans made it. Humans created that soil. And how do they create that soil? By adding charcoal. There is some controversy if this was on purpose or just a result of continuously slash and burn of the forest, and then that led to an accumulation of black carbon in that soil. But the end result is thousands of years later, that charcoal is still in the soil and is still working as an improvement of soil quality. And why don't we do it for the rest of our crops? This is the rationale behind the International Biochar Initiative. So the reason of that biochar is being proposed is a long lasting soil amendment that will improve the quality of the soils for the hundreds and thousands of years to come. So the things that we do now will have a long lasting impact in improving soil quality. So to make biochar is the same way you make charcoal, yeah? And you can do that at different scales for different purposes. So I will show you what we are doing now in our labs. We do this for research purposes, but of course, if you wanna do this for agriculture, large scale purposes, you will have to use different systems. So let's talk about starting from the smaller scale and then we go up in a way that we explain how this works. So to make biochar, you have to bring organic matter to a process. It's called pyrolysis. Pyro, fire, lysis, breakdowns. So you are breaking down organic matter by using temperature. This is the idea behind the pyrolysis process. So by doing that, what you really want to do is in order to optimize the process of burning the least you can on the biomass and keeping the more you can as charcoal, you need to have a slow combustion with low oxygen supply for that burning of that biomass. So the idea of the pyrolysis is that you have a slow combustion with a very limited oxygen supply. So what will happen is the type of carbon that is on that organic matter will turn into black carbon, which is very resistant for microbial decomposition and will have all these properties of increasing the water retention in the soil and the charge and the colloidal charge in the soil. So first, when we do it on the lab, let's go for the smaller scale and move up to the bigger scale. When we do it on the lab, we can do it in the furnace. And then while we do it on the furnace, we can regulate the temperature, the ramp in which we increase the temperature. The time that is being subjected to the temperature also. And all these things can be regulated and studied how these processes impact on the quality, on the properties of the resulting biochar. So that's the reason we do it on the furnace. So to do it on the furnace, you need to have a can, which we call a reactor, and the can must have a lid. This can, you will compact your biomass, your dry biomass inside that can, and you will cover it with the lid, and the lid will have just one small hole on the top. And what that will do is that that small hole will allow some oxygen to get in, but not too much. And then you will burn that at least for 1 hour in the furnace, at the temperature that you want to regulate. And at the end of this process, it will cover that hole on the top of the can and allow it to dry. And then you can see how much was left, how much was lost during that burning process, the charring process. And by doing this, you have a very specific conditions where you are producing the biomass and you can study the properties of this, yeah? The second type of system is a system which is, you can have a reactor which has a electrical power source, electrical resistance, where you can heat up the material using your electrical resistance. And by doing that, you can also regulate the temperature that you're making and the duration that you're making. So I will show you here the process of doing this. Ahmed here in this image is showing the wood chipper breaking down this biomass so we can compact it on the reactor. But you can use big chunks of biomass or compacted small chunks of biomass. And depending on how you are doing it, you need to offer more or less resistance for the oxygen to flow through this system. Because if you have small chunks and you do not offer a good compaction or put it inside a can or some closed reactor, that will turn entirely into ash instead of being charred. After you put your material inside your reactor, you just put it inside this stove and allow, regulate the temperature, and that is it. At the end of 1 hour, you can turn off the machine, wait it to cool down, and then you have your charred material. Yeah. So before you use this charred material, you need to grind it down for a small particle size. The next type of systems that we have here in the agriculture station is the one that was made by the research group from organic farming from Rhonda Janke, and it's a barrel style of reactor. And this barrel is as you can imagine, is just like a closed barrel with a chimney, and in a way that you have the opportunity to regulate the amount of oxygen that flows into this. So the procedure is either you have a barrel where you put the biomass inside, you light it up when the fire has sketched, you put the chimney on, and after a while you close the oxygen input for that system and let it burn with low oxygen. Or you have another system where you have two chambers. In the inner chamber, you have a closed system with very low oxygen input in the closer chamber. In the outer chamber, you let all the oxygen go. So the outer chamber will play the role of heating up the inner chamber, and the inner chamber will be the one that will be making the biochar. And all these systems that I described for you up to now, and you have only that you're losing energy. You know, all this heat that you were burning this biomass is just being lost. Nevertheless, there are several proposed systems where you can recover energy in this biomass process. And this energy can be recovered either by gas and oils or by the same heat that is produced during this burning process. So I will show here some images of some of these systems, where the spiralysis systems, where you can have them installed in large scale, and you have a double purpose of energy production and the production of biochar. So when this is one of the main limitations that we have for biochar widespread use. If you use the biomass to make biochar, the energy yield is quite low. If you completely burn that biomass, then you can multiply that energy yield a lot. So if you by any chance have the purpose of generating energy, most likely you will have the systems that you will use will be completely burning that. So in not making biochar in that process. And when you make biochar in that process, because of the high profitability of selling this material as charcoal, normally this industry will opt to use that resulting biochar as charcoal, not for agricultural amendments. And that is something that the only way to go around this actually is to by government regulation and some subsidizing this activity of biochar for improving the soil qualities. Yeah. So moving from how you make biochar to how you use biochar, how do you use biochar? There are some things you have to consider. Biochar is actually an alkaline amendment. So if you have alkaline soils like in Oman, you might have some problem of buffering this pH up. You don't want to buffer pH up when you have already alkaline soils. So how do you get around this? You include this biochar in the composting process, or mix the biochar at the end of when the biochar is ready, at the end of the compost. Mix the compost with biochar, and that compost will regulate the pH of the biochar, and at the same time will the charred material will bind to the organic matter on the compost and will help stabilize a little bit the compost for the soil at the same time. So you can have this mixed purpose of having a biochar and compost mixed together, and it will improve the properties of the biochar for amendment in alkaline soils like we have here in Oman. But if you're using for acid soils, the direct use of biochar is also recommended. And the only problem you would have for acid soils is that usually acid soils are high, has a high phosphorus fixing capacity. And by adding biochar, the biochar will immobilize some of that phosphorus when you recently etch the soil. So you might have a slight negative impact of decreasing the availability of phosphorus when you recently add it to the soil. So how you get around that? Either you mix that biochar with organic amendments, or you add some amount of phosphorus to that biochar, so that that biochar will not act as a phosphorus sink, but as a phosphorus source into the soil. So this is some of the things that must be taken into account when you use the biochar. The incubation of the biochar with compost or vermicompost before adding to the soil will improve its performance in the soil environment. And the things that you need to take care when you are using it for acid soils or alkaline soils are different. In the alkaline soils, you were looking more into the problem of alkalinization. And in the acid soils, you were looking, it will act as a lime into the soil, but you may have some nutrient immobilization. But in any way, in the long term, the biochar amendments will increase the carbon content in soils, and this high carbon content in soils will act positively in the chemical properties of the soil, the physical properties of the soil, and also the biological properties, increasing overall the soil health. Increasing overall the soil health. So this is all I had to bring for you today about biochar. I hope you enjoyed, and see you next practical.